I was really specifically interested in this group of worms because they have really spectacular eyes. It's really breathtaking to see the lengths to which evolution has gone to create a really special visual system for this one group of worms. We discovered this really special field site to find these worms on YouTube, it turns out. I've only caught a single individual in a trap in the past, and to see this video of thousands of them swarming somewhere, it really caught my attention immediately, and I looked up who had taken the video, who was diving in the video, and was able to track them down and got a hold of our colleague in Italy, Armando. He's a extremely experienced diver, especially at this specific island in Ponza, Italy, and he was able to tell us where we could find the worms, and he could meet us there and bring us down, and he guaranteed us he would show us them. We were, of course, skeptical because we know they can be quite rare and quite hard to find. But first night when we got there, we went in the water, and sure enough, there they were. Most worms do not have much for vision. They don't have very spectacular eyes. They have very low resolution vision. If you think of the common earthworm, it doesn't have any resolution vision. It doesn't have any sort of true eye. But these creatures are actually related to earthworms. High resolution vision is actually quite rare amongst animals. So we have long hypothesized that this group of worms, the alcyopids, these marine polychaete worms, are able to do this, but for a long time it's been really hard to study them. There's been very little work done on them because they're hard to get. So the big innovation we had was finding a place and a way to collect them in really good shape and be able to work on them and work out whether or not their eyes are capable of high resolution vision. So if these worms are actually quite delicate, so to catch them we needed a special apparatus. If you try to catch them with a fishnet, they'll get tangled, they can be damaged, they'll secrete a lot of mucus and kind of be a mess and be very stressed and unhappy. But we came up with an alternative strategy using a 5-liter wine jug that we procured from a bar at the harbor on Ponza, that we could literally just sneak up on the worms when they're swimming by and suck them into this big wine jug and then take them carefully up to the surface and bring them into the lab, and they were completely fine and happy and great for experimentation. Another really big challenge in working with some of these harder to find animals is that often you have to bring the lab to the field. And that's what we did. We brought microscopes and electrophysiology equipment and various types of other lab gear out to this island where we set up in our hotel room essentially a makeshift optical and electrophysiology lab. This is one of the heads of these worms that we worked on, scanned with a synchrotron in Switzerland. So we're able to get 3D volume scans of the internal structure of the eyes. Between that and the temporal resolution electrophysiology that we did in the field, we're able to tell how many pixels the worm's eye has, and we can tell what frames per second the eye can run at. And that really tells us then what they could do with the eye, what kind of resolution of vision they're able to achieve. And through doing that, we were able to show with this recent paper that the worms are capable of high resolution object segmenting vision in their natural habitat. In any sensory system, these animals are benefiting from hundreds of millions of years of evolution to tune this sensory system to do some very specific optical jobs. It's not entirely clear exactly now how we could adapt anything about the worm into human technology, but there's always lessons to be learned from how nature has really perfected certain types of sensory systems.